Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's edition of the Spectral Geometry in the Clouds seminar. Today, we have the pleasure of having Marco Michetti from the University Paris-Saclay, who will talk to us about maximization of Neumann eigenvalues under diameter constraint. As usual, if you have questions during the talk, you can either unmute yourself or just ask them in chat and we will relay them to the speaker. Marco, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the presentation. And before starting, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity of presenting these results. Today, I will speak about the maximization of Neumann eigenvalues under diameter constraint. And this is a joint work with Antoine Herreau. So I will start mainly by fixing the notation. So I take omega to be a connected bounded domain with Lipschitz boundary. And I am interested in the Neumann eigenvalues that are, of course, the eigenvalues of the Laplacian with Neumann boundary condition. Thanks to the assumption of Lipschitzianity, we have that the spectrum is given by a sequence of eigenvalues. And I will denote by mu zero the first trivial eigenvalue, that is the eigenvalues that corresponds to constant eigenfunctions. And then I have the increasing sequence of eigenvalues. The Neumann eigenvalues also have a variational characterization that is a way of computing this eigenvalue via a variational method. And the formula is the following. The kth eigenvalue can be computed as the infimum on AK of the supremum, and then I take the supremum of the Rayleigh quotient, that is the ratio between the L2 norm of the gradient over on the L2 norm of the function, of functions in AK. And the infimum is taken over all the k-dimensional subspaces of the Sobolev space H1. And I assume that this space is L2 orthogonal to constants on omega. So I am assuming that the mean of this function on omega is zero. The main topic of this talk will be I will denote by d of omega the diameter of the set, and we are interested in find optimal upper bounds for this quantity here, that is the diameter square times the Neumann eigenvalues. Or if you want to see this in another way, thanks to the scaling property of the Neumann eigenvalue, we can say that we are taking a domain, we are fixing the diameter of this domain, and we ask for optimal upper bounds for the Neumann eigenvalues for this domain. This problem were already studied, and the first results goes back to Cheng in 1975, where he found in the context of Riemannian manifolds, he found upper bounds for this quantity, and the bound that he gave in particular for the first eigenvalue in dimension 2 is sharp. Then Banuelos and Burzi in 1999 proved via different method a sharp upper bound for mu 1 in a slightly more general context than convex domains. They also characterize the maximizing sequence. In the same year, Kruger proved sharper upper bounds for convex domain in all dimensions. What I want to present to you today is, in some sense, sharp upper bounds for these domains in what I will call an optimal class of domains. So for I will be more precise about this later, but I want to start by defining what are the domain in which we are interested in. So I start by defining of what is an optimal beta concave function. So if I take H to be a non-negative bounded function, then H is optimal beta concave if I have this beta is strictly positive and is the largest number for which h to the power beta is concave. So I call it optimal beta concave because a property of general beta concave function is the fact that if I have a function that is beta concave, then it's alpha concave for every alpha that is smaller than beta. So I'm taking the largest beta for which this property holds. And I'm at any domain, I would like to associate a function, a one-dimensional function. And this function, I will call it profile function of the domain. And is defined as follow. I take a domain, omega in RD. Then I take the segment that realize the diameter of the domain. And then I take the hyperplane that are orthogonal. And I measure the intersection of the hyperplane with my domain omega. So what is this function? Is the Hausdorff D minus one measure of the point x prime in this plane, it is the plane that intersects the domain, of the h d minus one measure of the intersection. Our theorem, of course, we said two things. So we are interested in a domain for which the profile function is an optimal beta concave function. So the main theorem that we proved is the following one. So suppose I have a domain omega in RD, and then I denote by G the profile function associated to this domain omega that I recall it's a one-dimensional function. It's a function in one variable. Then if this function is 1 over alpha concave with alpha strictly greater than 1, I choose 1 over alpha because then it will be more the bounds will have a better expression. So if I assume that G is 1 over alpha concave, then this bounds holds. I want to describe a little bit this bound. For alpha strictly less than 2, I have that the diameter square times mu k is always less or equal than this number here, where we have a part that is with pi, and the other one is G01. In these bounds, in general, G nu m will be the mth zero of the Bessel function J with index nu. So here we have G01, so the first zero of the zero Bessel function, plus k minus 1 pi and all these things square. And notice that alpha is not appearing in the upper bound. If alpha is equal to 2, then I have that this is less or equal than k plus 1 pi all these things square. But now I want to stress this point. If alpha is strictly greater than 2, then we have these two bounds. And I want to stress the fact that now alpha is appearing in the bound. So this bound reads as follows. I have to distinguish between k that is odd and k is even, but this is not important. I have an upper bound, and you see that we have the zero of the alpha minus 1 over 2 Bessel function, and I have the k plus 1 over 2 zero. So now we have that the alpha goes inside the index of the Bessel function that I am searching for the zeros. And this is will be important later. And so we have these two bounds. As you see, in some sense, we have some symmetry when k is odd and not symmetry when k is even. And moreover, also what I would like to say is that all the bounds above are optimal. All these bounds are optimal. And all of them are achieved by a sequence of collapsing domains. So what I mean that if how I can reach this bound, I can construct a particular domain, omega, then I take the diameter and I'm making this omega collapse to the diameter, and in the limit I can reach this this upper bound. So as a byproduct, in this proof we proved in a different way the inequality of Kruger. Indeed, the convex case is a particular case of the theorem that we proved. Indeed, if I take a convex domain omega nrd, then by an easy application of Brun-Minkowski inequality, we can see that the profile function is 1 over d minus 1 concave. So this is a particular case of our setting, and we recover the inequality in the convex case. And also in this case, of course, we characterize the maximizing sequence, so the sequence of domain that saturate the inequality. But now I want to say why I say that this is an optimal class, because actually, thanks to this result, what we can do, what we can say is the following. If I take a domain omega and I fix the diameter, then actually the product diameter square times mu is unbounded. So there exists sequence of domain that makes this quantity goes to plus infinity, and this example of this were done also by Assanesat, Polterovic, and Kokarev, and also Alessandro Savo. But here, what I would like to say is that we have, in some sense, a geometrical characterization of this phenomenon of I fix the diameter, and then I can construct domain omega, for which the Neumann eigenvalue, first Neumann eigenvalue of this domain, it's really large. Indeed, by the theorem that we said above, if I fix any number m, then there exists a positive number alpha for which the first zero of the Bessel function g of the Bessel function with this index here, alpha minus 1 over 2, this is greater than m. And so what does it mean? It means that by the theorem above, that I can construct a domain omega for which diameter square times mu 1 of omega is greater than m. So in some sense, it's true that if I have a domain that has a profile function that is beta concave, I have an upper bound, sharp upper bound. But this upper bound goes to infinity when beta goes to zero. So if I am losing this kind of beta concave property, I'm constructing a sequence of domains that has unbounded first Neumann eigenvalue. So now I would like to present the main idea of the proof. And the main, one of the main objects in this proof is what I call the relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue. And I introduce this quantity now. So if I consider a bounded function that is non-negative, one-dimensional function, then I can define the relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue in this way. I'm taking the infimum over AK of the supremum of function inside this AK of the Rayleigh quotient. This is a one-dimensional kind of eigenvalue. So I have the u prime square times h in the numerator, and also I have this h that multiplies u square in the denominator. And the infimum is taken over all k-dimensional subspace of h1, that now I am asking this k-dimensional subspace to be L2 orthogonal to h. But why I am speaking about relaxed eigenvalue? Because in general, if I don't assume anything about H, this infimum cannot be achieved. So this infimum will be not a minimum. If this infimum is a minimum, so I have an optimal k-dimensional subspace, then this is an eigenvalue in the sense that at each eigenvalue, I can associate an eigenfunction. So the optimal subspace, k-dimensional subspace, will be the subspace given by the first k eigenfunctions, and there will be eigenfunction associated to these eigenvalues. But in general, if the infimum is not a minimum, we cannot associate the eigenfunction in some sense related to this relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalues does not exist. And this will be will cause some trouble in the proof and in the argument, and we will see how and when. So now, what is the connection between the Neumann eigenvalue under diameter constraint and this Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue? So if I take a domain omega and I call the profile function of this domain H, by easily taking k-dimensional subspaces that are done by one-dimensional test functions, we have this easy upper bound here. This is easy to prove. Now, what we want to do is, if I take any function h, I would like to construct a sequence of domains for which the diameter square times mu k of this sequence of domains converge to the relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue associated to the function h. And this can be done in the following way. So if I take a function h, then I call omega epsilon h be a domain with the profile function given by h, but I must multiply by this power of epsilon. So it's epsilon d minus 1 h. And if epsilon goes to zero, this quantity here, the diameter squared time mu k, converge to the Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue, the relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue. So the idea is that if I take a domain, then my domain has an eigenvalue always less or equal than the Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue, with h that was the profile function. But if I shrink this domain and make it collapsing to a segment, then in the limit, I can reach exactly the Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue. So now we want sharp upper bounds. So a classical way to proceed is to solve the related maximization problem. So we want to solve this problem, supremum of diameter squared times mu k, when omega is given by in a given class of subdomains. But by the things that I said before, this is equivalent to solve the following problem, to solve the supremum of relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalues when we take h in a given space of functions. And of course, the space of function is related to the space of domains that I'm considering. And in particular, in our case, so in the case of studying domain for which the profile function is optimal beta concave, this is equivalent as the following problem. So I'm taking the maximum, we will see that will be a maximum, at this stage is a supremum, of mu k of h to the power alpha, and h is a concave function. So this is a way we parameterize functions that are 1 over alpha concave, because if I take the 1 over alpha of h alpha, this is h, and h is concave. So the main theorem is the following. Now, in order to simplify the notation, I call function that are concave, so function in 0, 1, that are concave, I call it L. It's not important here that the max is equal to 1. So the main theorem is the following. If alpha is greater or equal than 1, then there exists a solution of this problem, but the main part of this theorem that I'm not writing explicitly now here, but is the fact that we have both an explicit expression for the maximizer. We really know the maximizer, what is the shape of the maximizer, really in explicit way. And we explicitly know the value of the maximum. And of course, the value of the maximum here are the same that I showed you in the main theorem. So we really know the value of the maximum. Actually, I want to do a little comment. The fact is that proving the existence of a maximizer is not difficult, proving the existence of the maximizer. What was the really difficult part is prove that the maximizer in the mu k of h bar, where h bar is the maximizer, is a real eigenvalue. So the difficult part is to prove that the relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue, that is the maximum of this problem, is not only a relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue, but is a Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue. So in the maximum, actually, there exist eigenfunctions which I can work. So this will be a technical problem in the proof and in the argument. So what I want to do is to show the main idea of how one can solve a problem like this, skipping this part. And how I can do this is by studying the case alpha is equal to one. In the case alpha is equal to one, what we have to maximize is mu k of h. So alpha is equal to one. And h was a concave function. And now, because h was a concave function, it's easy to see that for every h in L, there exists an eigenfunction associated to mu k of h. So we don't have any more, now at this stage, we don't have any more difference between relaxed eigenvalue and eigenvalue. They are the same because there exist eigenfunctions. And the theorem is the following. There exists the maximizer of the problem, A, that h. H star K, then we have the explicit expression of the maximum, that is 2G01 plus K minus 1 pi, that is exactly the number that was present in the main theorem, and we have the expression of H star K. And this is important to see now. H star K is given by, or is a concave function given by, or two segments that will be k is equal to one, so these two dots here will be the same, or it's given by three segments. So this is the shape of the maximizer. And now how one can prove a result like this? So how we can prove that if we have a concave function, we want to prove that this concave function is actually a function that has three, the graph is composed by three lines. Actually, what we can do now, of course, now from now on, the maximum is not anymore h star k, but will be denoted by h in order to be have a better notation. And u will be the eigenfunctions that is associated to mu, to the maximum. And now, as I say, the alpha is equal to one, so the eigenfunction exists. So how we can prove that the maximizer has this shape? We can prove it by proving that, so h is concave, h double prime is a measure. So if we can prove that in the support of the double derivative of h, there are only two points, so the actually h double prime is given by the sum of two Dirac deltas, then we prove that the shape of h is given by three lines. So how we prove this? In the first step, that also the difficult step, is proving that the support of h double prime is a discrete set with control on the sides. So we prove that there are at most k plus one points. Then we can refine the result by proving that there are or one or two points. And then at the end, by computation related to the shape of the eigenfunction, we are able to have the the final result. So now what is the idea? The idea is to analyze the optimality condition. So I'm searching for the maximum. So the first thing is that in general, study the first order optimality condition. That in this case, it reads in the following way. So the first order optimality condition is a linear function that applies on V is exactly this. So I take V and I multiply by this combination of U prime square and U square. So if I don't have any constraint, of course, a maximizer must solve that the first variation is zero. But now I have three constraints. I have the concavity constraint, so h cannot be any function, must be a concave function. And I have the constraint that h is non-negative, so is must be strictly, must be greater or equal than zero in zero and one. And this gives us some Lagrange multipliers that in these general settings reads in the following way. So the equivalent of the Lagrange multiplier in these settings gives us three objects. The first one is a function psi that takes into account the concavity. So there exists a function psi that is greater or equal than zero and is only zero in the support of S, when S, I denote S, the measure given by the double derivative of H. So the support of S is the set in which that I want to control the sides. And then I have two non-negative numbers, lambda zero and lambda one, such that we have the following. The first variation is equivalent to the double derivative of this function psi applied on V. And then I have lambda zero V zero and lambda one V one. These two are in some sense classical Lagrange multiplier. This is in some sense a generalized Lagrange multiplier that is actually the idea of this came back to general optimality condition that for instance were studied by Jimmy Lambollier and Adrian Novruzzi. So we have this. What we can say about this function psi? This function, actually, we can conclude that must satisfy psi double prime is equal to f, where f was the combination between u prime square and u square. And this gives actually regularity on this function psi. And so this is C1. And so now what we want to do, we said this must solve an ODE, is a C1 function that is zero on the support of the measure S. So now what we want to do is that I take an interval that is in the complement of the support of this measure. So in the idea is that I take two points, alpha and beta. Alpha and beta are in the support of the measure. So the function psi is zero on alpha and beta. This came from the optimality condition. And then all the interval is not. So, and the function psi is positive on the interval. So in some sense, we get a boundary value problem for psi that must solve. And we also know that because it's C1 and this zero on psi on alpha and beta, also the derivative must be. So this gives us two conditions that reads like here. And this gives us that F must vanish at least twice on alpha and beta. So I have the interval alpha and beta and my function F must have at least two zero inside this interval. But now what we want to do is we want to count how many alpha and beta there are. So how we count, how we can give an upper bound of how many of these there are. We know that F must vanish at least twice inside an interval given by alpha and beta. So if we are able to control how many zeros the function F has, then we conclude. And how we can do this? We can do this by relates the zero of the function f with the nodal interval of the eigenfunction, because by the theorem, current theorem, we know that there are k, in this case, there are exactly k plus one nodal interval. And if we can count how many zero f has inside the nodal intervals, we know how many zeros f has. And what we prove is that f must vanish exactly twice on each nodal interval. Here I'm not precise because we need to exclude the boundary nodal interval, but I'm not entering into this. So I can count the number of zeros of f. It has 2k plus 2 zeros. And in any interval of the type alpha and beta, it must vanish at least twice. So at the end, this gives us that there are at most k plus 1 intervals in the support, in the complement of the support of this measure. And this gives us the proof that H must be a polygonal line of at most k plus 1 line. So now we prove that there are H is at most of k plus 1 lines. How we can pass from k plus 1 to 2 or 3? We can pass to this by using this argument that is the following. So I have this set of points that are the points in which H change the slope. And I call it this point x1, x2, and xn plus 1. What we can prove? The first thing that we can prove is that, okay, h0 is equal to h computed in 1, that is 0, okay? And then now we can say that at any points in which h change the slope, the product of u and u prime must be 0. So what does it mean? It means that or u is zero when I change the slope, or u prime is zero when I change the slope. But then I can prove these things. I can also prove, suppose I am in a part in which h is linear and I am increasing. Then what I have is that I can say something about u, the derivative of the eigenfunction on the first point in which I started the line. So I can conclude that u prime is zero on that point. But also I know that at any points in which I change the slope, u is zero. So this for information, maybe the less clear is the third one here. But the idea is that now what we know that an eigenfunction cannot have, in the same point, cannot vanish the eigenfunction and the derivative. So in order to exclude this, so in order to don't have a contradiction with this, thanks to the things that we said here, we have only two possibilities. Or H is given by two segments, or h is given by three segments. Because otherwise, if there are more segments, thanks to these four points, I can find a point where the eigenfunction is zero and also the derivative of the eigenfunction is zero, that is impossible. So we have or two segments or three segments. So this is how h is composed. And then, thanks to this, we can have an explicit expression of the eigenfunction. And then, having the explicit expression of the maximizer is now only a matter of computing some computation related to the zeros of Bessel functions. So, what we proved? We proved that we already know that diameter square times mu k of omega is always less or equal than the maximum here, that we proved to be this number here. And then by the lemma of the approximation, so the lemma that gives us the fact that if I take relax the Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue, then I can approximate it by a sequence of explicit sequence of domains, I can actually reach this number by a sequence of domain that are given in the following way. The domain omega epsilon h bar k is a domain that has the profile function given by h bar k multiplied by a suitable power of epsilon. So this is the case. And this is was the case alpha is equal to one. Now I want to present you what is the main difficulties when I consider alpha greater than one. In all the arguments that I presented, of course, also in order to write the first order optimality condition, we assumed the existence of the eigenfunction. That is not always the case for extremum, for relaxed Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue problem. Indeed, what we can notice is the following. Actually, given an H, we can formally write the Sturm-Liouville ODE. So we don't write only the variational characterization, but formally, it is supposed that the eigenfunction exists, we can write the ODE. What is the problem? The problem is that if I have H that is concave, then the green kernel associated to this ODE is a kernel that is in L2 cross L2. So we have an Hilbert-Schmidt operator, and we have a sequence of eigenvalues and a lot of other properties that we used. In general, if I have H that is concave and alpha is greater than one, then the green kernel associated this time to the Sturm-Liouville ODE with H to the power alpha is not in L2 cross L2. So we cannot say that, for instance, for granted that this is a compact operator. So in principle, there exist no eigenfunctions. So the eigenvalue, we call it relaxed because you can compute it by the variational formulation, but there are no associated eigenfunctions. So how we proceed in that case? The idea is that we want to construct explicitly a maximizing sequence in which we know that there exist eigenfunctions. So the idea is that I construct a maximizing sequence that depends on a parameter, and then, but for each of these parameters, there exist eigenfunctions. So I can do computations and then send the parameter to zero. So the maximizing sequence is constructed as follows. I solve an auxiliary problem. So it's the supremum of mu k of h to the power alpha. H is concave, but h is greater or equal than epsilon. That is a positive number. And then we have these properties. The first property is that now, thanks to the fact that H is strictly positive, is greater or equal than epsilon, this is classical Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue problem. So there exists an eigenfunction associated to the eigenvalue, and we can prove qualitative properties of the maximizer, that I call it H bar epsilon, using the same argument as above. So you use the same argument, now it works because the eigenfunction exists, and we have qualitative property of H bar epsilon. So we know some qualitative properties of this sequence. A technical part that is now I'm skipping also the idea beyond this, but this is one of the main part on this, the proof of when alpha is strictly positive, is strictly greater than one, is to prove that H bar epsilon is a maximizing sequence. So we must prove that H bar epsilon is a maximizing sequence. And then at the end, we have that H bar epsilon converge here, I put wake star L infinity. Sorry, I forgot the L infinity. So it converges to a function h bar that is the maximizer. And thanks to the qualitative properties that we know on h bar epsilon, we are able to find qualitative properties of h bar And also we know that there exists an eigenfunction associated to mu k h bar to the power alpha. So this is the way we proceed when we don't know in general the existence of eigenfunction. What we did, okay, in general, we don't know the existence of eigenfunction, but maybe we can construct a maximizing sequence for which we know the existence of eigenfunction and we can work. And then the proof is, the end of the proof is the same as before because we have this equality, this inequality, but now we explicitly know the value on the right-hand side. And actually, we can construct the maximizing, the collapsing sequence that saturate the inequality above by easily taking a domain omega for which the profile function is given by a function that was the maximizer of the Sturm-Liouville problem multiplied by a suitable power of epsilon. And this will converge to the maximum of the Sturm-Liouville problem. And this proves the upper bounds and also the sharpness of the upper bounds because we can explicitly construct a maximizing a sequence that reach the upper bounds. So this is all the things that I would like to say, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marco. Thank the speaker. And we have time for questions. So if you have questions, please write them in the chat or unmute yourself. Go ahead.
I have a question.
Yes, Paolo.
Hi, Marco. I'm Paolo from Padova. Yes. Thank you for the talk, for the nice talk. So maybe it's a stupid question. Can you give me some example of a non-convex domain satisfying or not satisfying that the profile function of the domain is alpha concave? So what kind of geometric information gives this condition?
Ah, yes. For instance, take an easy domain can be in the plane. Take the graph given by x squared. So take x squared and take the interval 0, 1 to take the domain that is given by the region that is below the graph of x squared and above the positive plane. So this is not convex, but is 1 over 2 concave.
Okay.
If you take the square root, you have x.
Thank you.
And this is a domain for which that is, I think, optimal one-half concave, but the domain is not convex.
Marco, I have a simple question, perhaps also a naive question. What can you say when you remove these convexity assumptions?
There are sequences of domain that goes to, for which diameter square times mu k, mu 1, goes to plus infinity. And these domains are actually constructed. The idea is actually losing a lot of these beta concavity properties because our domain for which, imagine that our sequence of domain for which this profile function is some sense reaching a function that is zero everywhere and for instance, one in one point. So our function that are maybe like this, but then you are approaching the vertical with a really high tangent and then you collapse. And this makes you this diameter square, the diameter will be fixed, goes to plus infinity. And this characterization of domains that have large Neumann eigenvalue when you fix the diameter is always having this kind of profile function that has a really high derivative and small L1 norm and high derivative.
Anyone else wants to ask something?
Yeah, I wanted to ask something. Hi, thanks for the talk. I'm Rupert. So you explained in your talk somehow that concerning compactness issues, there are some things change at alpha equal to 1. But if I look at your formula, somehow the formulas change at other values. I mean, in particular, alpha equal to 2, if I remember correctly. Could you give some intuition why these formulas are so different in these cases, and in particular how the optimal ages change.
Yes, okay, I go there. Okay, there,
yes.
So yes, this I didn't speak about this, but this is also an interesting thing, is that for instance, if alpha is equal to 2, like I said in the previous things, I only proved explicitly alpha strictly less than 2, and the optimal was the one that is like this, or the one that has a plateau. Exactly. And in some sense, the plateau gives you this value pi here. Mm-hmm.
Exactly, so, yes.
In this case, for instance, alpha is equal to 2, you don't have... pi, you don't have g0 1 here, but you can notice that if alpha is equal to 2, then here alpha is equal to 2, so take the case alpha strictly greater than 2 and put alpha equal to 2, you will find out that this is the Bessel function g1 half.
Yes,
that is actually the 1 over square root of x of the sinus. So this gives you the fact that you have this pi here. Mm. And here the maximizer, this is the particular case where the maximizer in this case is any function h. So if I'm speaking of the maximizer of this movie, is any function h that has the graph that has at most k plus one line, and that is zero on zero and one. This is a particular case and is done to the fact that the g1 half, the zero of g1 half is related to pi.
Yes.
So this is the, and in the last case, we come back to having Bessel zeros. So the idea is that we don't have any more the plateau.
Okay.
So the maximizer here is only two lines.
Up and down, okay.
Yes, and it's symmetric in the case k is odd. So it's symmetric. And it's not symmetric if k is even.
I see. Okay. That explains it a lot. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We still have plenty of time if people have questions, so please go ahead. I think that's it. Oh, go ahead.
My question is, if we about inequality, if we have omega, a ball, like a ball or a sphere, do we have some equality or not?
No, for domain that are not collapsing, you don't have, in general, you don't have, you cannot reach equality here, because actually because of this, the idea is here. See the first line, we have diameter square of omega, mu k of omega, less or equal than mu k of h. But actually, this is not really a less or equal, it's strictly less, because if you had the equality, it means that you have eigenfunction that depends only on one variable. And this is impossible if you have a domain omega that is in some sense a given domain. So you take the square, then the eigenfunction does not depend only on, for instance, x1. Though for a given domain, if you give me an open domain, then the inequality that I show you are strict. So these are strict for any open domain.
Thank you. Does anyone else wants to ask something? If not, let's thank Marco again. Thank you very much, Marco.